Good afternoon, and welcome to the Institute of South Asia Studies at UC Berkeley. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Dr. Muniz Faruqi, and I'm on the faculty in the Department of South and Southeast Asian Studies. It gives me the greatest pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Mahatma Gandhi. Dr. Keshavjee is a graduate of Queen's University, Canada, and the School of Oriental and African Studies in London. He obtained his doctorate at the latter institution in 2009, the dissertation that focused on the role of alternative dispute resolution in a diasporic Muslim community in the United Kingdom, and specifically Mirpur, migrants, second and third generation migrants from Mirpur Khas in Hounslow, which is an area in London. At present, Dr. Keshavjee lectures on alternative dispute resolution and Islamic law at the Institute of Ismaili Studies, where he is also incidentally on the board of directors, or governors perhaps is the word that they would use there. So if there are any graduate students over here who are interested in a job or a postdoc, he's the man to speak to. But Dr. Keshavjee is so much more than just a simple academic. Offering a rare professional combination, Dr. Keshavjee blends an academic's credentials with those of a trained lawyer, having been called to the bar at Gray's Inn in London and Osgoode Hall in Canada. I believe Dr. Keshavjee occasionally even gets to wear his lawyer's hat as an advocate of the High Court of Kenya, where he practiced law for some years. In Dr. Keshavjee's cosmopolitan and broad-based educational background, and his varied life experiences as a second-generation South African, who has also lived for over 30 years in France, working in the Secretariat of His Highness the Archon, you begin to see what drives today's speaker. It is a deep humanism, I believe, coupled with a desire to heal wounded individuals and communities. Nowhere are these traits more apparent than in his stellar mediatory work, both within the Ismaili community, but outside it as well. It has won Dr. Keshavjee great recognition and many honors, and the list is truly long, so I'm just going to highlight the ones that struck me. He keynoted, for example, the 2006 Annual Congress of the Dutch Society of Family Law Mediators. He also keynoted the 2009 Seventh International Family Mediation Conference in Strasbourg, France. He serves on the advisory board of the Festival of Muslim Cultures in Britain. Dr. Keshavjee is also a member of the EU panel of international family mediators trained to deal with Hague Convention cases on international cross-border child abductions. And just over a week ago, Dr. Keshavjee was honored with the 2016 Gandhi King Akira Award for Peace in recognition of his global endeavors promoting mediation as a method of peaceful and amicable dispute resolution. Congratulations. But the reason we are all gathered here today, in some respects, is the launch of Dr. Keshavjee's recent most book, entitled Into That Heaven of Freedom. Part biographical, part historical, part didactic, and part inspirational, it is the kind of book that has a little something in it for everyone. And given that I, personally, am always looking for insightful books that I can give friends and family, I'm really looking forward to learning more about the Ismaili and Indian experience in South Africa between the 1890s and the 1990s. On that note, please join me in welcoming Dr. Keshavjee to the podium.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Faruqi. After an introduction of that kind, it can only be downhill. Thank you, all of you. I'm so grateful to be here at your Gush institution. I always heard about Berkeley when I was at school. I was wondering where on earth was this great place. Happy to be here today. My book is basically a journey I undertook myself. But it took 43 years to write. I know I'm a slow developer, but this is, breaks all records. It's a journey of an Indian in Africa, of a person of South Asian origin, living in Africa as a minority, straddling two major movements in the 20th century. It's like a spiral. One is the movement of what culminates in the apartheid state, and the other one is the decolonization process in which the Asian minority finds itself as an unwanted, unwelcome residue from the colonial experience. That's the Indian story in Africa. And the genesis of this book was on the 5th of November 1972. I was a practicing attorney in Nairobi. I went to the law courts, and as it's normal, Abdul, I think you may have just left Kenya by that time, come back from the law courts, everybody's got to go to the coffee shop. And so I picked up a newspaper, I saw a picture. And that is a very interesting date. It was the day in which Idi Amin had said, if any Indian was still remaining in Uganda, they would only have themselves to blame. Because there was one choice, either they would end up in camps or they would be in the Nile, where the crocodiles are all waiting to eat anybody's. I mean, I'm not joking, these were serious stories of a madman who used to talk this way, and he walked the talk. So there was I picked up the newspaper and I saw a picture. It's a woman with a baby trying to speak to somebody on the platform who I believe from the article was the Indian, somebody from the Indian High Commission, trying to pacify her. Almost a story said, don't worry, we'll sort it out. On the next window, there were three Indians. There was a man with a turban, a Sikh, and two others. And the caption said, they're being pushed to the sea on the trains that were built by the grandparents. And then the story said, they don't know where they're going to. So I looked at this picture, I said, oh God. I mean, it sounded quite odd. But it no longer was a photograph, it became for me a mirror. Because there was I, a South African, the South African passport, in independent Kenya, that had no relations with South Africa diplomatically. I was from a country that had left the Commonwealth a few years earlier, so I couldn't go to England, I couldn't go to any Commonwealth country. India at the time would not take us back. The Brits said, you're not our problem, you guys could have taken the citizenship of an African country. You had 2 years, you guys didn't do it. Now, we didn't come in that category. Many Asians did. But when we came out from South Africa, the government said, no, you can't even apply. You're going to be here 5 years before you naturalize to be able to apply. And by the time you were ready to apply, they said, we've frozen everybody's passports. So that was the predicament of the Indian settlement in Kenya. And as I was walking down the street, I met an American, African-American called Dr. Eugene Harper Johnson, who was married to an Indian girl. And I said, Eugene, did you see the newspaper? He said, hey, you're living in this country on the heartbeat of an ailing president. So he said, it's a matter of time. That was the situation in which this book emerged as a thought in my mind, but took me 43 years to finish for the simple reason that I began to search for my own identity, my own dignity, my own human rights, my own identity, not realizing that it was going to be another 15 to 20 years before I could call any country my home. And that made me go back to try and understand why was I in Africa? I mean, why the hell? I mean, I'm looking here, if you see the picture at the back of the book, I'm looking at the beautiful scene of the Indian Ocean, you know? If you go to the Cape, I don't know how many of you have been to the Cape, it's the most beautiful place on earth. And you see these two oceans merging. And I saw a little thing that looked like a slick, and that was Robben Island, where a man spent 10,000 days to bring a country to its humanness. And I said to myself, why the hell did my grandfather come here, or my granduncle? So I went into the Gujarat and tried to study what was happening in Gujarat in the 19th century. And I began to realize that it was quite a few things kicking in together. The drought, the famine, the breakdown of the landholding system, the corruption of the princely states nurtured under British colonialism. And then I said, oh my God, so that means that was the situation that pushed us out from Africa into different parts of the world. Some people went to Fiji, some went to Mauritius, some went to Guyana, some went to Trinidad, and my folks came to South Africa. But they came 1 year after another person had come to South Africa. And that's, do we have the clip, Shaina? I want you to see this little clip to give you the idea of where the narrative fits in. Maybe you can switch the light up so people can see it.
I will not leave this compartment. Where does it say reserved for Europeans only? Please show me.
Get off my train.
In the luggage van, that's for you. Get down here!
Has it mattered that he's a Parsi and you are a Muslim and I a Hindu? Why should it matter whether they are Christians or that they speak Tamil or Telugu? We have come here today to get rid of our dog collars, to burn these certificates of our humiliations.
You and your families will be protected.
We don't need your protection. All we want is that you put an end to racial discrimination. We refuse to be treated as outcasts because of the color of our skin. What?
But if you value your dignity and your freedom, then come, march with me.
Yeah! South Africa's first democratically elected president in 1994. It was the official end of white minority rule, otherwise known as apartheid. Apartheid, you've heard of it, but what exactly was it? I'm Francesca Fiorentini, and this is AJ Plus. Apartheid is an Afrikaans word that means separateness. It was a system of racial segregation that governed South Africa for nearly 50 years. It specifically aimed to protect the domination of the white South Africans over non-whites in every aspect of life. But it didn't just appear out of thin air. During the colonial grab for the country between the Dutch-descended Afrikaners and the British, the rights of native black South Africans were sidelined. So when apartheid was officially made law in 1948 by the Afrikaner-led National Party, it was a continuation of injustices already happening. Afrikaners believed that South Africa was their God-given homeland, and that the white race was superior. The black majority was therefore seen as a threat. There were 148 apartheid laws. Blacks had to carry ID permits at all times and had to obey strict curfews. Public facilities were separated for white and non-white use, and marriages between whites and other races were banned. People were classified into four racial categories: white, black, Indian, and colored, people of mixed race. And they were all separated into different residential areas. Blacks were divided into 10 so-called homelands based on tribal groups. Homelands were rural, overcrowded, and lacked jobs, forcing blacks to seek work as migrant laborers. Wages were low, and it was illegal for workers to strike. See, apartheid was also economically motivated. A cheap workforce was needed, particularly to work in the country's gold mines. Powerful mining magnates had a huge stake in apartheid policies, since their profits depended on keeping black wages low. Outside their designated homelands, non-whites had no political rights. Since they were not technically citizens, they couldn't vote. Education? Also divided. The state set up a separate education system for blacks that received a fraction of the funding that white schools did. Mandatory education ended at age 13 and was structured to funnel blacks into menial migrant labor. Exploitation by design. Needless to say, there was resistance to these insane laws. Protests were often led by black students and youth and were met with severe repression. Out of these struggles came leaders like Nelson Mandela, Oliver Tambo, and Walter Sisulu, who would help bring an eventual end to apartheid.
Rolihlahla, shaker of trees, he became Nelson Mandela and shook the world.
There was one peace standing on our feet, not kneeling on our knees.
We know him as the peacemaker, the president of a new South Africa. Now, at the time of his passing, Frontline tells the intimate and surprising story of a Mandela few people know, a bomb-throwing revolutionary who became a skilled politician in prison, a passionate man who sacrificed the love of his life for a country that needed him more. This is the story of a remarkable man of history who united a nation and inspired the world. The Long Walk of Nelson Mandela.
Oh,
That's the period that this book covers. From Gandhi's eviction from a train in 1893 to Mandela's release in 1993. It's the story of the Indian struggle in Africa as part of the larger black non-white struggle for political emancipation. Among the reasons why I was inspired to write this book is that as a minority in both Southern Africa and East Africa, we were constantly reminded that you are saboteurs, you are economic exploiters, you've done nothing, you were running the small dukas, little corner shops, we don't need you here. But nobody realized that the political process in Africa was largely inspired by the circumstances that brought India into the life of Africa. In 1860, there was an agreement between the British government in India and the Natal government in South Africa to have a lot of people come to South Africa to work on the sugar plantations. These people were promised that they would have a few years of work and then they would be emancipated and they could buy property. But they found themselves coming into slave labor. They were put into the plantations, they were beaten up, they were raped, they were robbed, they could not change the indentures. Gandhi didn't know about this. But ironically enough, in that struggle that he espoused after he was thrown off the train, lay the seeds of India's political emancipation, because Gandhi wrote the Hind Swaraj in South Africa, which is the blueprint of India's independence. Secondly, the Indian population, the Indian contribution to South Africa was quite interesting, because the whole notion of satyagraha, soul force, was developed in the streets of Johannesburg in 1906. And then you found that India took the whole case to the United Nations in 1946, the passive resistance campaign of 1946, and then the defiance campaign that Nelson Mandela championed was also largely with Indian people in 1952. This particular book then speaks about how communities survived. There were communities that were able to manage. For me, it talks about the Ismaili community and its contribution to social services in the area we lived in. We lived in this little town called Marabistad, which is 1 mile away from the Pretoria capital. I was born under a jacaranda tree around the corner here, which still exists, though the house was demolished thanks to the Group Areas Act. These two little girls on the cover happened to be my mother and her sister. They're playing Gujarati girls at the back of these tin shanties where they grew up. And this is the road where Gandhi used to meet my granduncle when he wanted to ride to go to the Union Buildings to meet Smuts in 1914. And on the other side of the road, a young African lawyer come boxer would come in his fatigues to meet his grandson planning the protest movement in 1952. But it was still many years before South Africa is going to be a country where all of them could vote. That only happened in 1994. So it's basically the story of the diaspora. It becomes important today because migration is a major issue. It's a major issue in the United States, major issue in England. I just got an email this morning from Refugee Action said, can you please help us? There are so many people who are being rejected into coming into Britain. And said, could you please come and join us? We want to speak up on these issues. I think these are some of the issues that have not gone away. How do people go from one part of the world to another? If I look around this room, I think about 98% of us all are immigrants. We're all with Asian background, we've come to the United States, we are re-scripting our lives, grappling with multiple identities in an area, depending on where you come from and what type of demonization we could be subjected to. It's basically a world we're moving in, where we have to develop the notion of a cosmopolitan Africa. That's what the globe is today. It's this whole situation that we are now moving into an era of biracial marriages, by national marriages, by religious marriages, by cultural, bilingual. This is the reality of today. Mr. Obama happens to be a president whose mother was from Hawaii and his father was from Kisumu in Kenya. I think up to then, no American knew where Kisumu was. Probably they much thought it was a disease, you know. But the point is this, that I think this is the world we're moving towards. And this particular book hopefully addresses the struggles of a people and how, when you do not lose hope and you do develop a certain civil society consciousness, you can navigate through it. Now, it's not a book about a family. I just happen to have an ability to look at things because I was born in the Ismaili community. But I'll just give you a few examples of how the struggle had tried to destroy us completely. We lived in a country where you could not be in the operating room in the medical school if a white body was brought in, a dead autopsy. All non-whites had to stand up and walk out. In a university, it's like as if you had a medical school. You have a medical school here in Berkeley? It's as if anybody who's of a particular color cannot see how the autopsy is done on a white body. People just got up and had to walk out. Then you come out of university, you cannot get your elective in the hospital. If you get into a hospital, you have to use separate amenities. If you are a lawyer, first of all, you can't get into law school. I would never have been able to go to a law school in South Africa. You couldn't. Your color disentitled you from going to a law school. Once you go to a law school, you can't get your articles. Once you get your articles, you cannot practice in certain courts. The man who drafted the Constitution of South Africa, Ismail Mohammed, 20 years ago, had to eat his sandwiches in a toilet of the bar council. He had to use somebody's, what you call, door tenancy. He had to see his clients when white lawyers were in court so that he had a desk. And yet this was the man, when Mandela came out of prison, he said, Ismail, I want you to be the Chief Justice of South Africa. He refused. He said, Nelson, I don't want you to. They were friends, they would speak together. He said, I'm not asking you as Nelson, I'm ordering you as the President of South Africa. And then Mandela was a good friend of his. He said, look, we won't last long, we'll die soon. But if we don't establish the credentials of the judiciary while we're alive, things will go woefully wrong. So then he said, if that's what you say to me as my President, I will go. And I believe within 2 or 3 years before he died, he restored the respect for the South African judiciary. A country where you had law but you had no justice. A country where there was parliament was supreme, but there was no democracy. And it was this man who drafted the drafting of the Constitution of South Africa, who came from a school from these little streets. So I think this book talks about the spirit of the human that soars when you are allowed to do things. It's the people in this particular road whose children produced the first double heart and lung transplant surgeon in the world. South Africa produced Chris Barnard, but it also produced the first lung transplant surgeon in the world. So, Nevinathan Pillay, somebody mentioned her this morning, was it you? You must have. Her story is in my book. Eventually becomes United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights. These are people who could not even go to law school. These are people who were not allowed to have offices. These are people whom the apartheid police would pick up if they were defending somebody who were caught for petty offences. So the book speaks about that particular problem, and it also encompasses the Ugandan expulsion with Idi Amin, when he expelled the entire Asian community in 90 days because he had a dream. God had told him that make sure these people leave on the 90th day. And everybody listened to what God told him because no other country stood up. The tragedy of the nation state. When ideology prevails, nation states lose their voice. It becomes very convenient. So these are some of the issues I think that are confronting the global society today, which I hope this particular memoir would catalyze. This is not a textbook, it is a story. And it's also my story because I could only write it when I was able to forgive. I hated the whites of South Africa. I'm honest enough to say that. Today, I'm honest enough to say that I love the Afrikaner. I do not say it out of condescension, but people who have come into my lives and have helped me in our lives are some of the Afrikaners. It's only when I was able to get them off my back that I was able to script my life as an overseas Indian who came to realize that I didn't have to hate India to find my identity. And I didn't have to reject my Western identity to have my Indian identity. But I needed 100 years of the families movement to reclaim who I was because of the colonial system in which I was born. And these were some of the things that the book meant to address, which I hope it will. I've been very fortunate that I grew up when I was about 3 years old when this horrid ideological system started. I never thought as a kid that in my lifetime it would ever end. None of us ever thought we'd ever see Mr. Mandela's face in our lifetime. But it happened. It had to happen. And I'm happy it did happen. Having gone through the process, I would ask myself, so have we reached the heaven of freedom that Tagore mentioned? Is that what we fought for? If we see a girl is raped in India and the judiciary said, well, she should have stayed at home, 10 o'clock at night, what was she doing outside? Is that the country that Tagore spoke about, we thought about fighting for? I'm not saying things are bad in India, but that whatever goes wrong, we have to stand up. And if I see something going wrong in South Africa, I ask the question, is that what Mr. Mandela fought for? And that's where civil society, civil consciousness, and the ability to stand up for principles come very strongly. And so I hope that that will inspire that sort of a discourse. Now, I've spoken so for too long, I'm going to leave it to you, Dr. Kiyoki, to try and see if you can open the discourse.
Thank you. So what we'll do is we'll take questions and hope to hear Keshavjee's voice. But if you have questions, you just wink at me and I'll make a mental note of it and pass them on to him. So please, go ahead.
Thank you very much. You're articulating the capacity to resist. And to do so from a place of care and of principle. What would you say produced that in you, in your life? What cultural legacies?
I think we were very fortunate to draw on quite a few resources, which probably we were not aware of at that time. You might be of the joke about the centipede that was asked, how do you manage your 1,000 feet together at the same time? And he thought for a moment and became paralyzed. So if you asked me this question in South Africa, I wouldn't know what I was doing, you know? I think people had an inbuilt resilience. You know, when I think of the giants that South Africa produced during the war, during the struggle, a person like Mr. Mandela, I mean, it must be tremendous, tremendous inner resources. A person like Mr. Kathrada, L.B. Sachs, Governor Mbeki, these are all people. There were women in the struggle. In my case, I think what I was able to draw on, we had the legacy of Gandhi's contribution to our family. There was a close connection. But I think it was also the community in which I was born. But people lived in communities. I was very fortunate that in the Ismaili community, the Aga Khan was a great believer in education, in voluntary, setting up clinics and setting up schools which were open to people of all the this race, and there were individuals I didn't realize. There were individuals that sent food to poor people, nobody even knew they were doing it. Mrs. Pillay, who cooked during the treason trial, she's in my book, one woman, 156 trialists for 3 years, she got food clandestinely and made sandwiches for people and sent her children to go and feed the people. And the whole day fed were people from all races. So I wonder, what was it that really created that feeling that, look, we got to survive? And there were whites, very few and far between. People like Beyers, Noddy, people like Fisher, Breitenbach, people like Chris Barnard, they fought this, but I can, it's a handful of people. But I think there is a certain resilience. I think we are wired for goodness. But it's like W.B. Yeats says, you know, the best lack of conviction, the worst are filled with passionate intensity. But there were some best who were very good, that they did stand up. But in our case, I think in my case, now that I reflect and I go back, we had happy families. We had parents who did send us to school. We had good teachers. Some of our teachers were whites. They taught us good things. And we were able to garner the little education we were able to get with the community spirit that we were able to garner, with the understanding that, you know, we got to survive. And we laughed. I mean, when I talk to my siblings, they think those are the happiest days of their lives. We think of the fun we had as children. We were born into the situation, but we didn't lose hope. There were times when we were angry. In my case, I only began to become angry after I qualified as a lawyer the third time in my life. I was more upset with having to do that than being a victim of apartheid when I couldn't go to law school. And it was the after apartheid, the aftermath that irritated me. And I had to get that out of my system. Yes, Melanie?
I'm sure it wasn't a single instant in time that was more cumulative, but can you talk about when you recognized that you were forgiven? Was it the writing of the book that...
I think it was cathartic, yeah. Yeah. It was, you're right, it wasn't a single incident. There were so many incidents, you know. We had to decide which day of the week to have a toothache because you couldn't find a dentist. I'm not joking. And I lost some of my teeth in high school because we couldn't find a dentist. Can you believe it? I mean, it's unbelievable. You tell somebody something like that today, they'll think you're mad. So there were many points at that time. When did I feel that I have completely gone over it? I was fortunate. There were role models in my life. Of course, Gandhi always loomed in our life. When I saw Mandela coming out of prison, I was in France. I couldn't believe. You know, I mean, that moment was, and I know it met many South Africans. We all cried. We literally cried when we saw him coming out of jail. And some of the things he did, it's not human. He did on that scale of humanness what the apartheid did on the scale of evil. He was able to match evil with good, but not for any political purpose, because he believed that if he did not forgive, 35 million people would not be able to forgive. Mr. Mandela was able to do something not anybody was able to do. And I saw those type of things, and I was very fortunate. I worked with the Aga Khan, again a remarkable man. He didn't spend 10,000 days in jail, but he's a man whose sense of understanding of these human issues is very, very deep. And I was with him at the time when the Ugandan situation started. I wasn't with him then. But when I worked with him in the institutions, properties, and people's rights were being recognized, he was not vindictive. On the contrary, he said, whatever you took from me, let me use it to help the people of Uganda again. Well, they were not members of the Ismaili community, they were not even Indians. But I think those type of moments gave me a feeling that my little bitterness was just basically petty compared to the larger vision that people were espousing. But it did take time, I must be honest with you, it took a lot of time. I know people who still feel very bitter today. You must get a book called No Future Without Forgiveness if you haven't read it, Desmond Tutu. It's probably the most beautiful book, and quite a few people read it.
Thank you.
Given the achievements of Nelson Mandela and his capacity during his own lifetime, and certainly in some extent his death as well, to heal South Africa, where do you feel South Africa is moving today as it gets further and further removed from the lifetime of Nelson Mandela, but his example even more importantly? You hear reports about, you know, Zuma and corruption and a rising tide of ethnic, notions of separateness and notions that some groups are you know, belong to South Africa, other groups do not. Yeah. And so, I mean, in terms of your own experience of South Africa, but then, of course, your experience as someone who's been living out of South Africa for all these years, I mean, what's your sense of where things are moving in South Africa?
I think South Africa has a very good democratic structure. You know, the constitution is very, very powerful, number one. Now, constitution is as powerful as people make it happen. You need a judiciary that's very robust, it's fit for purpose, it all works hand in glove. I was amazed to note, I spoke in Los Angeles, it's at the University of Southern California,
right,
a few days ago. I'm losing my memory. You Americans are very smart. I'm here for 30 days giving 40 lectures. So if it's Tuesday, it's going to be Belgium. All right. Varun Soni is a professor there, and he reminded me that Mr. Kathrada wrote a letter on his blog to say the president has to give up power. Now, here's an Indian in Africa telling a black elected president that, look, you have to step down. This will not work. This is not what we fought. Look at his moral authority to do that. So I am of the belief that, like India, the African National Congress has a certain charisma. This is the party that fought for freedom. So ANC will be around for a long period of time. But I am of the belief that if people could vote Thabo Mbeki out of office, whose father had spent 27 years in jail, if Thabo Mbeki could be told, look, we're not voting you in, I have a feeling you'll do the same with Prime Zuma. Number one. Number two, South Africa is a crisis of expectations. 350 years of racism, of slavery, cannot change the structures of society overnight. To bring about a transformation of society, which originally was based on racial lines, will take a lot more time. And in today's resource-strapped world, that is not an easy task. That's number two. Number three, as an overseas Indian, and I have mentioned to the Indian community in South Africa, do not be perceived to be in a privileged position. Participate civically into the country. Help the Africans to come to a higher level of living and existence. Do not be perceived to be the minority with all the money in your pocket. Beautifully put by an African journalist, lady journalist, when somebody said, what do you feel about the Rainbow Nation? She said, we're not a Rainbow Nation. This is cappuccino. You get so much black coffee, then you got a sliver of white froth, you got a few pieces of chocolate in it. Which I thought was very good, very happy. So you do find a very robust electorate, educated, conscious, and I do not here stand in judgment of Mr. Juma, that's not my job. But what I'm saying is that these are people who have fought and they will ask for a democratic process, governance, which is difficult. I can empathize with Mr. Zuma, but I can also see that unless people see the fruits of what they fought for, you will not have stability. And it's a very interesting mix of people. And I think that the more communities can get together to help share the resources that the country has to offer, it will make relationships between nations and people and races much easier. And I think Mr. Mandela meant that. That's what he stood for. And I think Mr. Kathrada was going to sponsor my lunch in South Africa. He's not sitting on a pedestal. He's trying to bring these kids together. They do programs on restorative justice, I believe. They train people to become bankable, help in the townships. They're trying to reconstruct society. It doesn't come overnight. I mean, Kenya, it's taken 40 years. How do you change colonial structures overnight? You can't just take something away from somebody like Idi Amin did and give it to somebody by saying, all right, because you're black, you should have it. But on the other hand, you can't say to somebody, you've had it so long, and if they don't have it, it's tough luck because you are stupid and they're clever. Where does the government balance the whole thing between being part of the international community, protecting private interests, a certain way of doing business, but at the same time also ensuring there's greater equity. It's not an easy task. It would take time, but I don't know how it will happen.
Yeah, as somebody who's lived in South Africa and in Kenya, I'm wondering if you have any thoughts about the difference in the Indians' participation in political processes, their political consciousness, etc., between South Africa and Kenya.
Yeah, very good question. Thank you, Abdul. Very few people know that there's a photograph in my book. It's a very interesting photograph. Probably the only time it's published is in here. Sorry about that. Sorry. Yeah, I can't find my own picture. I did write the book, I promise you. It wasn't ghostwritten. Yeah. Okay. There's a picture of a Christmas party, 25th of December 1952. One of the leading British lawyers, D.M. Pritt, QC. This chap is known as Achru Kapila, a Punjabi lawyer. And that's Nehru's ambassador, Diwan Chamanla. It's at a Christmas party at our home, my uncle's home. Got all of us into trouble in South Africa because they said these guys are financing fighters and professionals. Basically, Kenyatta's whole defense team was financed by the Indian community in Kenya. You may say that's one incident, but if you go back in 1923, Jeevanji and Surman Birji Das, these were all Indians who really fought to stop Kenya becoming going the same road as Rhodesia. But unfortunately, as Milan Kundera says, the struggle of man against power is the struggle of memory against forgetting. We have not written our history. And the only thing we hear of the Indian contribution is that you're all exploiters, you're economic saboteurs. I think we need to bring the historical perspective forward. Now, the demographic situation kicks in. Kenya did not have the same population as South Africa, the Indian population. South Africa's Indian population at the time was 750,000 people, number one. Number two, the whole movement of Yusuf Dadu, Dr. Naika, and Dr. Suma in 1949, the three institutions, the oldest political party in Africa, was started by Mahatma Gandhi, the Little Indian Congress, 1894. Gandhi was the first secretary of it, and the second secretary was an Ismaili, the Al-K Khan. So there was a greater involvement in South Africa, and there was a greater giving of yourself. The Indians went into prison. Kathrada was in prison. Dadu lived in exile. Kacharya lived in exile. Muslim women went to prison. You know, Amina Kacharya, Fatima Mir, Zainab Aswad, these are all doctors. And Mani Ben Sita, there's a whole list of people who were in prison. They actually went into prison. So I think you saw much more of that giving of yourself to the move in Southern Africa as opposed to financing processes that was in East Africa. Just a different methodologies and dynamics. But I think it's important that Indians in East Africa, Indians in Africa, should have that consciousness that there was a contribution beyond opening up the interior. I mean, if you take East Africa, Seva Haji Paru, Alidina Visram, they were the people who went to the interior, opened up the whole interior for monetizing the subsistence areas of Africa. But I think also we need to have some background that there was Indian contribution to the political processes that shaped the contours of modern day Africa. I mean, Nyerere recognizes that, Kaunda recognizes Gandhi, Nkrumah recognized Gandhi, that there was that recognition that the whole non-violence movement during the decolonization process was inspired by Gandhi's work, as it was at America, Martin Luther King. Martin Luther King really followed Gandhi. I remember the Secretary of State telling me, he said, you know, Martin Luther King came here and said, we're going to follow Gandhi. He said, I said, this is Chicago. Nobody does. But it's just interesting that Gandhi was able to inspire.
I'm trying to phrase a larger question about the South African Indian community. And currently, right now, you mentioned Jacob Zuma, and there's this controversy around the Gupta brothers and their role in deciding or telling who is going to be a minister. And that's, they maybe left, maybe went to a wedding. We don't quite know at the moment. I don't know how much you're involved with that, but I'm curious because I have not heard an analysis of how the Gupta brothers are seen within the South African context, within the Indian. I mean, they're not, as far as I know, I don't know if they've taken South African citizenship. They were born in India and then have relocated there. But I'm curious because, especially the xenophobic attitudes in South Africa in multiple ways, whether or not they're seen as part of the South African Indian community, or everybody thinks, oh, they're just foreign. If that at all plays into how the Indian diaspora is seen within South Africa. Or maybe it's just totally separate.
No, I don't think so. I haven't been to South Africa recently. I don't think I've been back for about almost 8 years, 10 years. I'm going in July. I've spoken to some South Africans and say, look what's happening. I mean, yes, somebody comes from outside and starts behaving this way. And I think many South Africans feel, Indians feel pain to say, look, this is not we, it's not us. So it's a question of governance and the notion of how business gets done. Now, I haven't done a deeper analysis, either from a scholarly point of view or even anecdotally, except for speaking to people in Canada from South African background. It will become problematic. Let me give you another picture that I saw myself when I went to Uganda some years ago. I have a very, very close Ugandan lawyer friend, a black Ugandan. And we went out for dinner one night, and we were at a hotel. And he said, look at the dynamics here. Of where the African is, where the Asian is, and where the white man is. And you know something? There was an unwritten type of a drama that was very similar to the post-colonial period. There did not seem to be that openness of trust and people being able to work together. Now let me give you what I meant. We were in a hotel there, most of the waiters and waitresses were Africans. The persons who were at the till were Asians. The owner of the property is probably living in England. So this guy tells me, he says, Mama, look at this. He says, just watch. And I know Peter very well. Peter and myself went to school together. We went to law school together. When he was expelled by Idi Amin, he came and stayed with us. But he said, look at the dynamics. How do you explain that new people learn? And the question is that if somebody comes to invest in the country from overseas, they probably have a pre-colonial idea that this was good, it works. But I think we have to be culturally literate, we have to be politically sensitive. You know, that political consciousness, that sensitivity, that you've got to treat people like humans. Now, I think that there is that whole dimension of how do people look at each other in stereotypical ways, if they did, how do you dissipate the prejudice of the past, and how do you develop an ethical framework for the present? How do you work with people and treat them not less than human, not less than what you want you yourself to be treated? It's not an issue only in Africa. It's a global issue. We have to come to grips with it. So people may say I'm living in cuckoo land or all that. I'm not a prophet, neither am I a preacher. But I'm just talking about what I went through my life myself. And if we want to treat people well, we got to treat people. So that problem, I do not know how it plays out in South Africa, but I think it would give rise to concern at more than one level. Probably I'll learn when I get there soon. Any other questions? Yes, yeah, the gentleman.
So in countries like Kenya and South Africa, the South Asian community has established its presence for a few hundred years now. What about countries like in Central Africa or West Africa,
yeah,
where South Asian communities only been around for a couple of generations? Where do you see their role and their position?
Central Africa is?
Like Central Africa or West Africa.
I don't think the Central African diaspora is any less long. It's about more or less the same. The Indian modern diaspora in Kenya, I think, in East Africa, is about the 1860s. Though the Gujarati trade took place over 1,000 years during the Omani trade routes. You know, the monsoon winds brought the Gujarati. It was Vasco da Gama had a Gujarati pilot that took him to, from Malindi to Calicut. So Gujaratis were there already, you know. They were either on the boat, they were outside the boat, or they were going to jump on the boat. You know? So the boat was quite prevalent in their lives. In Central Africa, the Asian diaspora is very small. It's not too big. It's partly Zambia, Zimbabwe, and Malawi. A very close friend of mine, Krishna Sajani, is a leader of the Indian community. It's small. It's a business community. And I think they've sort of gone with the process of independent Africa, and they're playing their role as business people and all that. I think the bigger hotspots were like Uganda, Tanzania, Kenya, South Africa. Malawi, Zambia, Zimbabwe, smaller communities, but they played their role. They did play their role in the, I don't know how prominent they were in the political process, but they played their role as business people. And now I think they're sort of important contributors to the country's economy. But they're not big. Many of them have come to England as well, as they saw conditions becoming a little difficult for England. Zimbabwe would be a case in point where more people would have left because of Mugabe's, the question of the farms and the whites and the racial tension. And so many of them went to England to settle. I was also surprised to know there was a small Indian community in Ghana and Nigeria. How are we doing for time? Are we okay?
Okay.
Yes, any other questions? Yes, Melvin.
I'm just wondering, how do you share this experience with the youth? Like when you address teenagers that may be, or college students who may be far removed from this.
Yeah.
I think of my generation, yeah. My parents came from East Africa and from Uganda and went through all this, so I feel a very deep connection to this.
Yeah.
But I also do a lot of work with youth, and they're far removed. They're second yeah. generation. And so how do you build almost share this information with them so it's meaningful, but also build that understanding so it's relevant.
Mm. I'm sure my parents asked the same question as I was growing up. You know? Youth tend to be far removed from these issues. I mean, I have a large family. My one brother said, I'll probably buy one book of yours, because I'd share the two kids read it whenever they want to. Mm-hmm. So I said, why? He said, why do you want to burden my kids? Why do you have to burden my kids? Now that's my second brother. I love him, really. I love him to death. Crazy as he is. The third brother said, I'm buying 10 copies. He's only got two daughters. I said, why? He said, when they get married and have kids, I want them to give one autograph copy to each kid. See, same family, different approaches. But what has happened, very interesting, you should ask me that question, that I was on the Skype last night. A school in Ontario is using this book for children from 120 countries to say, how will you capture your memory? And so we have this 18 kids who are writing the script, having me on Skype yesterday. And they wanted to know, what music did I like when I was a kid? And I said, Mary Makeba, what was the song that you liked? Was it Pata Pata? I said, no, Pata Pata came much later. I remember her click song. And I said, oh my God, I grew up on Nat King Cole's Mona Lisa. So I think we want to instill in our children an understanding that there was a story there. And that story is so rich that it will give you a sense of you belong somewhere. You have an identity. And it's very interesting that I found myself comfortable in my skin because I began to forgive those who wanted to dehumanize me, and I began to understand that I'm bigger than what I thought I was in terms of culture. I mean, Rabindranath Tagore is part of, I'm part of his culture. I'm part of Gandhi. I'm part of Nehru's Krishna Destiny speech. I can feel proud that Krishna Menon spoke at the UN, what he did, Mother Teresa, what charity she did, Satyajit Ray for his movies, Shiv Kumar Sharma for the Santur. All this was denied to me. But at the same time, I'm very proud that I was educated in Britain. And I can enjoy Shakespeare, I love Chopin, but I also love I love the Tamil gesture as well. And I think Ashwarya Rai is very beautiful. I could be forgiven. But it's that I've been able to recapture my identity beyond the diaspora that brought me to where I am. I can't define my story in 40 years. I've been looking different. And I can't define my theological identity in 500 years because I'm from India. Because the Ismaili Tariqa of Islam goes back to the time of the founding principles of Islam. So your theological identity, your cultural identity, your professional identity are all concentric circles that hopefully can live in harmony. And that's where the cosmopolitanism comes in. That we tell our children that, look, you can be Americans, be proud of being Americans. Henry David Thoreau was great, you know, John Steinbeck is a great writer. But you could also enjoy Rumi. You could enjoy Hafiz. You could enjoy Indian music. And I think the ability to navigate diasporically through all these processes. And I think I'm very happy to tell you that the Tariqa board in England has started World Reading Day next year, with each kid talking to the grandparents, you know, keep a journal, start writing. And I'm sure we'll really get connectivity there. The grandmother will be very happy to tell. There's a book here in America written by Mira Jane called Motiva's Tattoos. This is a girl whose mother is of Danish extract, father is Gujarati. He came to work in Seattle with Boeing Corporation. She grew up in this country and she couldn't speak Gujarati, but she and the grandmother bonded. And she's written a story of that. It's funny, it's hilarious, you've got to read it. But I think if we can capture that, it'll be fun. Yes, madam.
I have a question. In terms of some of the research and scholars who've sort of written about like moral development.
Moral development.
Yeah. In terms of like children or adolescents who are growing up in environments such as the ones that you describe, where they're continuously exposed to human rights violations,
sure,
and injustice,
sure,
and unfairness, and inequality, and the list goes on.
Oh, that's a big list.
Right. There are some that would say that growing up in that sort of context perpetuates that for the next generation, and we've obviously seen that. But then there are others who say that given the right environments within this larger environment, that these children and adolescents can actually grow,
yes,
and positively engage, yes, with, yes, these moral concerns.
Yeah.
And not necessarily needing to reach that stage of sort of forgiveness 20 or 30 years,
yeah,
later, but maybe more more immediate as they're engaging with the negativity,
sure,
of,
yeah,
that environment. In your opinion, from your observations, from your experiences, from, you know, your writing, what would you say are some of the key features that these children would need to have in their lives in order to break that cycle?
I think good education. Civic engagement is very important. I tell children, you know, in your neighborhood, help people, be good human beings, be part of your community. I would think sound education. And by what I mean by sound, mm-hmm, education, an education that's much more culturally sensitive. Understanding two cultures, understanding big issues we are facing globally today, all have the provenance in earlier unsettled issues. A better understanding of some of the unsettled issues, the cultural dimensions of people's lives, I'm not sure we have it in all schools, in all educational institutions. I think that our children, if they had that and critical education, it's humanistic education in addition, not in substitution for, but in addition to good scientific education, I think that would be a way forward. But I think our children should be engaged in the global conversations of the day. There are big, huge global conversations. My wife deals with tuberculosis, and she said, you know, you've got to remember this. You mention this when you get your whatever you get. The tuberculosis takes only $20 to cure, and yet the millennium goals are receding. So I think the consciousness of people's struggles and understanding of what you can do to contribute towards their alleviation would be something so beautiful if our children embraced, in addition to being good in this country, doing good things in this country. I don't think there's an easy fix, but I think children are idealistic. They're going to go, they're going to do things. I mean, kids of Ugandan expelled people, I'm amazed. Somebody gave me a ride yesterday, and she said after the expulsion, I went to Uganda to a school called Arua. I said, do you know where Arua is? I don't know. She said, my mother and my father gave money to start a school for the children in that village that they were expelled from. So I think it's so nice to see our kids being participating in those type of processes where they don't keep the hatred of the past, but look at the problems of the present and contribute towards that. Now the AKDN does it beautifully, but I tell people AKDN is not the only pathway. Do it with as many institutions that are doing things as part of the civil society, within the country and outside. I hope that can happen. I think more and more we see our kids. I tell youngsters, go to university, take a year off, go and work in Bangladesh in microfinance, go to East Africa, work on water management, go to the mountains of Kilimanjaro, find out how the Maasai's do fishing. Help, wherever we can help with small things. So you're transferring your knowledge, you're transferring your competence, you're helping somebody to make a change in their life. Even if it's a small thing, change one family, you change humanity. You know, small things. You know, go to some places, help them, help the kids to start, you know, accessing higher education, help them to eradicate a disease or do certain things. I think we have to take those into consideration.
You're just picking up on that comment. I think it's so interesting, your prescription in some ways for us as individuals, but also for nations, is participating in these larger global conversations. After all, we only have one earth, so to speak.
Sure.
And yet in this country, I mean, I was just struck by what you were asking us to do, both as individuals, but also as citizens, is that we have, in fact, stepped back from some of the global conversations in this country. And I can think of, you know, a couple of examples. Think of, you know, climate change.
Sure.
And denial of climate change in this country. Think about the big migrations that are unfolding across the Middle East and Europe, and our offer to only let in 10,000 refugees. And that too is now on ice for various political reasons. And you can just work your way through a long list of issues where, you know, this country where, you know, we all live, and I have kids who are growing up over here, and we would like to have them participate as global citizens, we find ourselves caught between policymakers who often are absolutely blind, but also a younger generation that yearns for precisely the possibilities of going beyond. And, you know, we can see it on this campus, where, you know, you have programs like the Global Poverty Practice Minor and a whole set of other programs that are overenrolled precisely because they give avenues to students. And this is perhaps not particular to Berkeley's story, but, you know, across the board, you know, people who are in colleges and universities in the United States, Canada, of course, is a leading example of this, are desperate to become part of this global conversation, and yet they meet this kind of bulwark of opposition that is both political and in this country, for example. So the question I think that I have for you is, how does one overcome, in a sense, the obduracy, the stubbornness of, and perhaps an older generation, perhaps ideologues who don't get it.
Yeah.
And, you know, given the fact that you, a lot of your life has been devoted to the whole question of mediating conflicts and getting people to work things through, to my mind, the stonewalling seems, I mean, I wouldn't even want to engage it, to be very honest, because it seems so stupid to me. And so I was wondering if you had some lessons for me, perhaps as an individual, as to how I can possibly have a conversation with, say, a climate change denier, and, you know, in a sense, move us to the next level where, you know, we can engage in the kinds of positive outcomes that you have, you know, perhaps addressed in your book, but also in your own life's work.
You know, there are very, very many Americans who have tremendous sense of commitment. I've seen that, come across individuals. And think of the Ebola thing in Nigeria. I think people went from here. Quite a few people went from England. My mind goes back when I was in school. I think you had a young president here called John F. Kennedy. I don't make a pitch for any particular political party, but Kennedy fired the zeal of America at the time. You know, you had the Peace Corps, and people went out to Africa, and they went to the villages and all that. There was that newness of contributing and bringing about a new dispensation. There are institutions today which are allowing for the transference of a lot of knowledge to those parts of the world where people could gain from it. I can think one, the AKDN is one institution like that, through which people are going. I'm amazed to note that there were a lot of young kids that went from here to Afghanistan when the rehabilitation took place through the AKDN. And they worked on the ground. I mean, there was a symposium the other day, they said the AKDN was one of the only entities that lived up, they walked the talk. So I think AKDN is one, it's not the only one, but I think that if our children could spend maybe 6 months or a year going to some parts of the world, there are so many places in the world where little interventions can do things. Now, I am not sure that the government would say don't go, unless it's a place which is dangerous or America has problems with. But there are 190 countries. And I, in this one trip alone, I've broken for three kids to go to Geneva to work on the International Social Service. I said, they've got no money. But I spoke to the Secretary General. He said, like, send them here, the bright kids, they're going to work, we're going to put them to work. So they're going to go into work in Geneva in the next 3 months. So I would very much encourage, not only encourage, but Professor, if you've got some bright kids, Rotary International has remarkable amount of resources for conflict resolution in Thailand, in Brentford. This is money, scholarships being given. And if we can get kids onto that train, I think we will find a lot more kids will probably change the world. And we can do it. I think in the United States we will be able to do it. Maybe Canada does it in a much more collectively globalized, state-oriented way. But I think it's something we should try in ourselves as part of civil society, try and encourage this to happen. I think it would be lovely. And I think people in those countries will really welcome children coming in. They will embrace them. It's the opposite of what the United States did in the 60s when people came to study here. You find somebody from different countries said, I have an American sister. I know three, four people. Yesterday somebody, I was in Seattle staying with somebody, Almas, and she said, oh, my American sister was in Missouri. Because when they came from Tanzania in the 1960s, American families embraced them. Now, if you put the shoe on the other foot and say, if American students can go to different countries and work with people in the fields, in the villages, teach people English, help to eradicate small things, I think if we can afford it here, because those countries won't be able to afford to pay for them, and maybe the United States may not have money to say, we'll send you there and we'll pay for you. But I think there is a way in which we can still nurture that type of a relationship and have kids go to these countries. And I'm sure that if there were any families who wanted to do that, it would not be impossible. I've seen this on the strip alone, I've got three kids going across to Geneva in the last 2 weeks. I just sent two emails. I was lucky, they said, look, we've got an opening, let them come, just let them know which time they can do it. And I would encourage those of you who have young kids, brothers or sisters, you know, through the Rotary, through institutions like AKDN, through the United Nations, through the Institute of Transitional Justice, there are so many NGOs. Let your children go to some part of the world to make that little change. Because that little change will bring so much close cosmopolitan relationing, but it's also such a beautiful feeling for somebody to give. Because when they come back, they'll be enriched. They will see another culture, another dimension. But I don't know whether we can get it done from top down. Maybe we just have to push it from bottom up.
Final question?
Okay, Munira, you seem to be looking at me as if I said something wrong.
No,
I'm teasing. Munira is my benefactor. She's my mother, Teresa.
Mention of children suddenly makes one's mind go back.
Yes.
Well, I would like to thank all of you for coming, and definitely also to thank Dr. Keshavjee for gracing us with his presence. And before we can, you know, go our separate ways, can I please just ask Munira maybe to say a few words, just to close the event?
Sure.